Hello there, thank you very much. We move on now from the grand genre of epic poetry to the humbler type of mini story that is fable. But as you'll see from the baby's own Aesop here, we're staying with texts that carry moral messages that we think of in the modern world as being particularly suitable for teaching children. And fables are perhaps the ancient texts that are best known to more people today than any other. The stories of the tortoise and the hare and the boy who cried wolf, for example. Next slide, please, Matt. So first, I want to think briefly about possible audiences of fable, and then we'll think about what a fable is and what it's for. And then I'll move on to what we think we know about Aesop himself, before ending with examples of his influence. On to slide three. If you search online for Aesop's fables, the kind of thing you find is a host of modern retellings of the best-loved fables for children of all ages. And we do find this idea that they are particularly suitable for children in the ancient world too. And we'll see that on the next slide, where we have a description of Aesop in a Greek text from the 2nd or 3rd century AD. The author, Philostratus, is taking us on a tour of a gallery of paintings, among which is a depiction of Aesop with his fables. Here's what Philostratus says. Aesop told stories about all aspects of human life, and he has given the animals speech so as to make a point. So talking animals are being seen here as making it easier to get the deeper meaning across in a way that highlights aspects of human behaviour. He continues, for Aesop criticises greed, and he goes after insolence and deceit. And insolence there is hubris, that ancient Greek idea of getting too arrogant, doing violence to other people as a result. It's a lion, he says, or a fox, or by Zeus a horse that plays this part for Aesop. And not even a tortoise is without a voice, and we're going to hear from a tortoise a bit later on. Through these animals, children become students of the business of life. So what we see here is the idea that fables are particularly used in the education of children. And interestingly, Philostratus talks here about them being students of the business of life. And that perhaps reflects the way that many of these fables carry a message that basically says, this is how the world is. People just are greedy and insolent and so on. And we have to find ways of dealing with that reality. And the modern translators of Aesop in the Penguin Classics and the Oxford World's Classics series do make this point that much of what happens in these little stories is quite violent and unpleasant, reflecting harsh realities of life, and particularly once we get beyond the most familiar fables that we feel today are most suitable for a young audience. Next slide, please. But as we see in Socrates' words in this excerpt from Plato, Aesop is something for adults and for philosophically minded adults too. Socrates, while in prison, composes his poetic versions of Aesop because the stories are easy to remember, which I had at hand and knew, he says. Presumably, that's because they're short and because he learned them at a fairly young age, so they're very familiar to him. And in fact, we know from later collections of exercises that survive for people learning the art of public speaking that the first exercise you would do in that training was the retelling of a familiar fable in your own words. Particularly suitable for retelling then, and not just by children or for children. You'll notice Socrates uses the word mythos, a story or a myth, to describe the things that Aesop writes. And this might make us wonder what is specific to a fable that makes it a special kind of story. If we move on to slide six. Here are some factors that scholars generally point to. A key factor is that fables are very short stories. Secondly, many feature talking animals, but not all of them. For example, the boy who cried wolf has only humans speaking, and some have talking objects, like a pot that talks to the rain. One important aspect of these stories is that they're fundamentally jokes, either describing amusing situations or ending with a kind of punchline. This idea that one can use humorous means to put across serious messages is prominent in ancient Greek literature. And I've given the Greek term for it here, spoudorgeloion, or serious but a source of laughter. And of course, a fable contains an explicit moral, which sometimes comes first to introduce the story, or more often at the end of the story, sometimes spoken by one of the characters, but often added by a narrator. On the next slide, the great scholar of fable, Ben Parry, points out that fable has to be short because it has to make this moral message as clear as possible. The teller of a fable, he says, is concerned before all else with the metaphorical meaning of his story, which he consciously aims to impart without delay, and to which his story as such must be strictly subordinated and made summary in nature, and thereby brief and fast. I've summarised in slide 8 a story that is traditionally included as one of the fables. Heracles, Hercules, finds an apple in his way. Being Hercules, he smashes it up with his club. But whenever he does this, it grows bigger. The first thing that's unusual here is that we have a named mythological character, and also that we don't have any talking animals or objects. What's also unusual is that a new character pops up at the end, here the goddess Athena, to interpret the meaning. And it's also unusual for something in the story to represent an abstract concept, quarrelling and strife, in quite this direct way. Nonetheless, this is a short and simple story, and it has a clear moral message which recalls what I said earlier about the message often being about how we can best deal with the way that things are in the world. In the next slide, I've given a couple of quotes from A Survey of Fable by the novelist and literary critic Lee Rourke, who highlights how the humour in fables, that spoudogeloion that I talked about, is often quite nasty. It's mockery, ridicule and outrage. In that last slide, we are perhaps meant to laugh at Heracles for his tendency to use rather unnuanced means to deal with problems. And the second passage here highlights how the world of fable is exaggerated, sufficiently different from the real world, where animals don't talk in this way, that it feels a safer way of examining human behaviour by giving us, to quote, distance from ourselves so that we can observe our own actions from afar. On to the next slide, please. I'm going to show you a couple of fables that illustrate something that students have taught me when we've discussed fables and their morals. Many of these stories suggest multiple possible messages which are not necessarily all that well reflected in the morals traditionally attached to them. Here's a really short one-liner about a fox who is reproaching a lioness for having had only one baby. "Yes, only one," said the lioness, "but it's a lion." The obvious moral is something to do with maybe quality, not quantity, perhaps. And a traditional moral for this one talks about having one really good soldier as being preferable to having lots of very average ones. But it seems to me maybe there are other morals that we could take from this. I'll leave you to decide for yourself. But perhaps we could look at it from the fox's point of view. We might see it as a warning that we can make ourselves look foolish if we try to present ourselves as superior to other people without fully thinking through the implications. And on to the next slide, here's another one. This one, the traditional moral might seem a little unsatisfying. And here's the talking tortoise that I mentioned. A tortoise decides not to take up the invitation to go to Zeus's wedding. Zeus gets angry, and this becomes a kind of just-so story that explains that it's Zeus's punishment that means that tortoises have shells. The moral is therefore something much more about power and social relations than the one that's given here, which just says some people prefer to stay at home and not go to parties, which I think is not a particularly deep insight. Now, I think that this range of possible ways of interpreting the fables actually encourages the reader to reflect on whether a moral fits the story. So, as I've been suggesting, they can be a good tool for the reader to actively engage in working out which option for the moral, in fact, teaches the most insightful lesson. And Laura Gibbs, who has done a lot of study of fable, talks about this in terms of, to quote, different moral codes confronting one another. So The didactic moralising of fables can actually make us more aware that the same story might have different meanings to people with different worldviews. On to slide number 12. Okay, then I quickly wanted to give a summary of some key points in the ancient traditions about Aesop. As with Homer, there are various different traditions about him, but there are some things here that seem to have been generally accepted in the ancient world. I'll not go through them all, you can have a quick look at them, other to say that most of them are found in a fantastic text that's a combination of biography and historical novel, which we call the Aesop Romance. The date's quite uncertain for that, but it's well worth a read to get an idea of how Aesop was being thought about as a person. And moving on to the next slide, what I want to do is to end by talking about Aesop's influence. But first, I think it's worth noting that although Aesop is often thought of as the inventor of fable, as I was just suggesting, it's actually a much more ancient story type. And I've given one example here. It's the familiar story of the fox who can't reach the grapes. So he says they aren't worth having anyway. And that, of course, gives us the expression sour grapes in English. It's widely known because this is one that appears in lots of modern versions, like the one that I've given here. In fact, it goes back to a Near Eastern Sumerian story from the second millennium BC. And we have a dog there rather than a fox. There are dates rather than grapes, but it's recognisably the same story. The dates, he says, are bitter. And I'm not going to get them, so I'm going to say that I didn't want them anyway. Next slide, please. Fables have been popular down the ages, and I've given here a selection of European versions through the centuries, all of which contain different selections of fables. So there isn't really any one fixed tradition of what the fables are. And dealing with all these different versions is quite a challenge, as you'll see from the next slide, where there's a diagram that shows the complex relationships between the different collections. But to end, I just wanted to look at another ancient Greek text, which is on the penultimate slide. This time it's from the 1st to 2nd century AD author Plutarch, and it brings together various aspects of what I've been saying. Here we have a philosophical investigation into the question of animal intelligence, but it's presented in the form of a conversation between Odysseus and a talking pig called Grunter or Gryllus. He can talk because he's one of several of Odysseus' men who have been turned into pigs by Circe in an episode that's familiar from the Odyssey. Odysseus begins by saying that he's asked Circe to turn them back again into humans, but Gryllus turns down the offer, explaining that he prefers to be a pig. On the first slide, Odysseus thinks that he's done him a favour, but he's about to learn otherwise. And this is my final slide, number 17. Here we see the spudogeloion in action again, a serious discussion of whether it's better to be animal or human is presented through this slightly ridiculous image of Odysseus talking to the pig. And I think Plutarch's readers would surely have immediately thought of the world of fable. And this text, I think, recalls fable in a few ways. First, the idea that an animal could impart wisdom to humans. And also an animal has an experience as an animal that has something to teach humans. But there's also the idea that Odysseus is being like a child that we get coming into this final one, running away from lessons. And that reminds us that fables work well, precisely because they don't feel like medicine or lessons, but more like jokes. And as Gryllus argues that it's a good to change from one shape to another, he reminds Odysseus that Odysseus himself is like a character in one of these fables who thinks he's being clever, but is caught out by another animal's superior understanding of the way the world works. And Gryllus himself has learned this by becoming effectively a fable character. We laugh not only at the odd situation of the talking animal, but also at Odysseus, who is now made to realise that the change that we see in fable, where the human world is transferred to animal form to allow us to see ourselves anew, makes us, as he says here, healthier and wiser. And I think that's a good note to end on.